All right, everyone, welcome to the Tonto's Demise. Let me get my crap together here. All right, let's see. Organize the old desktop. I'm all disheveled. Anyway, welcome everyone to the Tonto's Demise Week 13 recap. The final week of the regular season is in the books. Little Tuesday, December the 8th. So, of course, a little John Lennon there for you, commemorating the 40th anniversary of his unfortunate and untimely passing. Usually like to go head us into the playoffs with a little bit of traditional, Danger Zone, Highway to the Danger Zone by Kenny Loggins, I think. But it's December 8th, so we gotta... John Lennon will always precede Kenny Loggins. A good rule of thumb for life, teach your children well. John Lennon always comes before Kenny Loggins, but in most cases. Anyway, week 13, the regular season is now finished. Checking my watch here. The week actually just wrapped up a few minutes ago. Baltimore and the Cowboys. And we did have one matchup that was riding on that game. And it ended up, Ginzer Jags did get the points they needed to pull past Ed Lager for to keep on with the Baltimore Ravens defense. To secure that win and keep his number two seed and the bye week for next week. So with that, the end of the regular season. Mighty Midgets, thank you for playing. Ed Lager, thank you for playing. See you next year. Shawshank Athletics, thanks for playing. We'll see you next year. Darkwing Jutt, thanks for playing. We'll see you next year. Saquon at 8-0, thanks for playing. We'll see you next year. Dubsy Hooligans, almost forgot about you. Thanks for playing. We will see you next year. Make sure you... I know this really doesn't matter too much, really, in the grand scheme of things, but if you'd like, if you are out of the playoffs, Yahoo still does a consolation playoff thing there. And Yahoo, if you still do, if anybody, I don't know how many people actually pay much attention to this, but it keeps track of like our records for year, every single year. I don't know, you can't access it from the app, but if you go onto Yahoo under like the league tab, one of the selections I'm looking at right now is record book. So if you go in there, it shows, whole bunch of different statistics throughout the year, and then what the all-time records are. I posted on the Facebook page the past couple of years there, the record book at the end of the season. But anyway, just for your own personal records, and plus Yahoo does like ratings and levels. If you want to keep your rating from dropping too much, even though you're not in the playoffs, there is a consolation playoffs, so you should set your lineup. Anyway, you don't have to do transactions or anything, but I mean, unless you really want to, you're still free to do whatever you want. But I would suggest that if you would, you know, always make sure you set a lineup, because Yahoo always it does affect the record book. And for example, if you don't start a quarterback, if your quarterback gets hurt, and say week 15 or 16, you're starting somebody who is out. You get a zero for that, for the passing yards or whatever. Those numbers, the playoff numbers, still get recorded in the record book. So that'll still go down. And you could end up being, you don't want to end up being an all-time low number in the record book from a week. It will show it in the playoffs where you didn't start certain players at certain positions or things like that. So in the grand scheme of things, it really doesn't matter. But if you check the record book, as I do every now and then, just to see where things stand overall in the league. It's kind of fun to look at. If you don't mind setting, just making sure you, even if you're out, just keep setting a lineup through the last couple weeks there. But again, it doesn't matter because the consolation playoffs are really, other than that, in terms of Tonto's demise itself, the consolation playoffs on Yahoo are essentially irrelevant. And the Mighty Midgets could go 3-0 in the next 3 weeks and end up, according to Yahoo, in seventh place at the end of the season here. But as we know, Mighty Midgets will be the last place team and thus hopefully sporting that beautiful powder blue Philip Rivers jersey at next year's draft. So, all right, is there anything else to get into here? I don't think so. So let's get into what happened here in week 13. As always, we start with the defending champion from Gags to Riches. He was looking to maybe move up and get a bye week. If a lot of things fell his way, he could have gotten all the way up to the number one seed, but that would have been pretty tricky, and it wasn't able to happen. But other than that, he secured the victory. I think even if he would have lost and gone to 8-5, he would still be in third in the number three spot. So going against Mighty Midgets, this matchup really didn't make a difference. Said Gags could only have moved up. He could not have moved down from the results of this one. But anyway, Gags to Riches gets a victory. 181.55 to 127.45 for the Mighty Midgets, sending him out on a sour note. For Gags, we have Deshaun Watson, 50.5. Tyreek, 14.8. Cole Beasley, 28 points. Julio, 15.5. David Montgomery, 27. Jalen Richard, running back from the Raiders there, 2.7. Kelsey, 27.6. Slayton in the flex, 2.5. Tucker, your kicker, 8.7. I know that because I just figured it out. It's fresh in my mind there. And the Arizona Cardinals defense, Yahoo says 4. That was actually the correct score, 4 points. But more than enough to get you past Mighty Midgets this week. Philip Rivers, 49 points. Brandon Cooks, Tyler Boyd, and Nelson Aguilar. Cooks goes for 11.5 in their debut without Will Fuller. Probably would have hoped for a little bit more there, as you said, you had the receiver to your opponent's quarterback there, so probably would have liked a little bit more, but didn't go. Tyler Boyd, he goes for 14. Actually, he had a long touchdown, so I'm sorry, 17.2. His only catch of the game, I see here, and then he got ejected. So he did manage to get you a 72-yard touchdown before leaving the game there, so a 17-point play. And he quickly bows out afterwards. But at least he got you those 17 points first. Aguilar, 7.8. Miles Sanders, only 3 points. Jamal Williams, 5.5. Goedert, the tight end, 11.5. C.D. Lamb, here just a little bit ago in your flex, 10.5. Gostkowski, 3 points. And the Chicago Bears defense, Yahoo says 5. I believe the actual total was 11. Even though they lost the game, had a sack, a couple turnovers, did okay. But 127, not enough to get a win more often than not. And Gags, with this victory, he will move up to 9-4. He will finish the regular season in third place. And Mighty Midgets will drop to 2-11. And he will finish the regular season in 12th place. All right, I said Yinder Jags, we'll do them because they were the only other matchup that really had anything coming down to Tuesday night. Feels weird saying that. But let's see, according to my notes, Ed Lager had about a 13. Well, okay, he had about a 13-point lead. Plus, well, he had Mostert there last night for Detling. So the lead was about 8 or 9 points, about 8 or so, 8.5. For Ed Lauger over Yinzer Jags, but again, Yinzer Jags had the Baltimore Ravens defense, and their actual score was 16, and you won by about 8.5. So yeah, the score for the difference must have been about 8 points there. So, but Yinzer Jags needed that victory to keep his bye week, or else he would have dropped to the 3 seed, which would have made things actually kind of interesting, because then we would have had a podcaster battle in the first week of the playoffs with 3 versus 6. But unfortunately, it did not fall that way. Would have made for an interesting podcast in week 1 of the playoffs. Anyway, Yinzer Jags gets the victory, 162.65 to Ed Lauger, giving it the old college try on his way out, 154.15, but could not spoil things a little bit there for Yinzer Jags. Speaking of, he goes Kyler Murray, 38.15. Devontae Adams, right below your quarterback, on his tail there with 34 points. Adam Thielen, 21.5. Pittman, 9.5. Austin Eckler and Mostert, 10.8, 5.3. Tonyan, your tight end, 14 points. Let's see, Booker, another Raiders running back here since Jacobs was out, 6.1 in the flex there. Rodrigo gets you about 7.5, and the Ravens defense, again, 16 points. Just enough from them to get you past Ed Lauger, who had Derek Carr go for, let's see, I always want to say David Carr for some reason. Still, it's been how many years? Derek Carr. He goes for 65.5 points. Played him since you didn't want to wait and see what Lamar Jackson was going to do, if he was going to be available or not for sure. He ended up scoring 37, 38 points. only 12 completions, but almost 100 rushing yards there for Lamar Jackson. But anyway, 65.5 for Carr. His 3 receivers, Michael Thomas, Cooper Kupp, and Sterling Shepard. 19.5 for Thomas, coming on a little too late for you here. Kupp, 15.5, and Shepard, 5.2. Perhaps a difference maker here in this matchup, as Ed Lauger only lost by 8. Antonio Gibson for the Reds. The Cincinnati Reds? No. The Washington football team. He got you only 1.4, 14 yards there. And he went out with an injury, though, very early in that game. So this matchup, if he doesn't get hurt very early, said only needed 8 more points there. And probably would have had gotten a pretty good amount of playing time there for Washington, based on how the game went. Very possible that he gets those points if he stays healthy in this game and turns the outcome the other way. But what happens is what happens, and Gibson did get hurt and perhaps cost you an upset victory here, Ed Lauger. Kareem Hunt, 8.5 points. Zach Ertz, 5. James White, 3. McManus, about 5.5. And then the Green Bay Packers defense, Yahoo says 16, but we bumped you up, I'm going to guess, to about 25. So pretty good performance from your defense there. So you got about 90 points from your buns, Carr and Green Bay, but a lot of single-digit scores there, teen scores, not able to get you past Yinzer Jags, and perhaps said make him have to play an extra game in the playoffs there. So Yinzer Jags breathing a sigh of relief tonight. He moves up to 9-4. He will stay at the number 2 seed, and Ed Lauger will drop to 4-9. I'm going to guess he will still be in the number, he will finish in the number 11 spot. All right, let's just keep going down the line here. Disco versus the Shawshank Athletics. The Shawshank Athletics had an outside chance, quietly snuck his way back up into playoff contention here going into week 13. Disco pretty much had a spot locked up. I don't think he could have moved down. He could have moved up maybe to one spot, which I think he did thanks to Possum Magic losing here. But if Shawshank Athletics gets this victory, which they did not, that would have been win number 7. And because Hillbillies on PCP went down this week and finishing 6-7, that means Shawshank Athletics could have made the playoffs if he could have just gotten this victory here at the end of the regular season. But alas, he did not, and he will be a spectator of this year's playoffs. Disco gets the victory 208.9, his first 200-pointer of the season, courtesy of Darren Waller's 48 points, while Shawshank Athletics won 55.25. All right, for Disco, Mahomes goes for 50.5. His three receivers, Marquise Brown, Mooney, I don't even know his first name, David Darnell Mooney, starting him, and Mike Williams. Hollywood goes for just under 15 points, thanks to a touchdown. And Mooney and Williams both score 8.3, exactly the same. 4 catches, 43 yards for both of those guys. Dobbins, he goes for 13.1. Jonathan Taylor, 22.5, almost 100 yards and a touchdown there. Again, Waller, 200 yards, 13 catches, 2 touchdowns, 48 points. Zeke in the flex, 13.5. Carlson, your kicker, about 8.5. And then the Washington defense, they got you 21. Is not Yahoo says 9, but the actual score there was 21. So getting over 200 points for Disco, first time this year, probably feels pretty good heading into the playoffs here. Shawshank, he had Herbert. Surprisingly, did he do okay last week? Yeah, he's been okay. This was his worst performance as a starter all season. Only 30.5 points. His previous low was 41, but he's been in the 40s, 50s, and all the way up to the 70s previous weeks this year. But unfortunately, even if he had gotten you 70 points, it wouldn't have made a difference in this matchup. Also, that probably would have meant that Mike Williams did a lot better than he did. So, Shawshank, that would not have helped you get a victory in this matchup. His receivers, A.J. Brown, Jefferson, and Perryman. Brown, 10.5. Jefferson, 27.3. And Perryman, 3.2. Perhaps the Hillbillies kind of are maybe perhaps regretting getting rid of Jefferson there with his receiver core. But then again, you got Chubb, and Chubb has an excellent, at least on paper, playoff schedule here. So running backs, McKissick and Gurley. McKissick goes for 10 receptions. Pretty much all of his points there came in comeback mode. And actually, they ended up getting the victory. As we know, the Washington football team over the Steelers there. 17.8 for McKissick and 3 for Gurley. Engram goes for just over 7. Debo in the flex, 13.5. Gonzalez, your kicker, about 3.5. And then the Miami Dolphins defense, Yahoo says 18. But you are bumped up about 20 points. So I'm going to guess their actual score must have been about 37, maybe 38, possibly. Well, he bumped you up 40, so it must have been about 30. I'm going to say we added 21 would be my guess. So about 39 for a good game. At home against the Bengals, who obviously, as we know, lost Burrow. Still no Mixon. Boyd got suspended, got ejected. So anything that could have gone wrong for Cincinnati and right for the Miami defense in this game did pretty much happen, other than getting a shutout, I guess. But you'll take 40 points from your defense every single time you can get it. Unfortunately, it was not enough for Shawshank Athletics to get the victory and steal that last playoff spot. He will finish the season 6-7. And even though he is 6-7 and Hillbillies also making the playoffs at 6-7, the point total knocks you down. And I'm going to guess you'll finish either 7th or 8th there. While Disco, with his victory, he will move up to 8-5. And I believe he will jump from the 5 seed all the way to the 4 seed. All right. Dub C Hooligans versus Darkwing Jutt. Exact same situation here. Darkwing Jutt just needed to get a victory, and he would have made the playoffs, assuming Shawshank with his loss here. Let's see. If both of you guys had won, oh man, that would have been really close, because I see Darkwing Jutt was only 9 points ahead of Shawshank in total overall points. So actually, if both of you had won this week and gotten win number 7, it looks like Shawshank would have just barely squeaked out that last playoff spot, because your difference here was almost exactly 10 points between the two of you. And like I said, Shawshank was behind Darkwing by 9.3. So yeah, you would have, if both Darkwing and Shawshank won this past week, the last playoff spot would have gone to Shawshank by maybe less than 1 point. Wow. Crazy to think about that scenario. Unfortunately, it is not what played out. But again, this matchup was much like Disco versus Shawshank, where one team was fighting for a possible playoff berth and the other didn't really matter either way what happened to him, but he was trying to play spoiler and knock. Well, obviously, in this case, Dub C, not with a playoff spot, just trying to take Darkwing Jutt out the door with him into the consolation playoffs. And he does that. Final score, 198.95. Dub C popping off this week. Darkwing Jutt, he only gets 145.05. For Dub C, Russell Wilson, 43.5. His receivers, Allen Robinson, DJ Chark, and Brandon Ayuk. Robinson, 13.5. Chark, 6. Ayuk, 20.5. James Robinson and Edwards-Helaire started him, even though he did not play at all. Robinson, fortunately, got you 22.8 to counter that 0 for Edwards-Helaire. Jordan Reed at tight end, he gets a touchdown, goes for 12.2. Gaskin is back. He's in the flex, 14 points. Last time we get to talk about Younghoe Koo this year. He gets a couple field goals, gets you about 12 points. And then the big one here was the New England Patriots defense. Very surprising outcome. They'd had a touchdown there, a couple turnovers. They shut out the Los Angeles Chargers in Los Angeles. Even though it said Herbert had been having a great season so far, Belichick somehow does his magic on Herbert and said kept them to 0 points. Just all-around, I think, surprising outcome in that matchup. Very easily could have envisioned the Patriots winning that game, but 45-0, never did not, absolutely did not see that coming. But anyway, so I guess I should say the Patriots defense, Yahoo says 39, but so the Chargers did still get some yardage there. Looks like we bumped you up about 15, I'm going to guess 15. So 52-ish, 54 over 50 this week for the New England Patriots defense. I believe they did have a long touchdown there too, so there was a bonus in there for that as well. For Darkwing Jet, unfortunately his final week, and he had once again quarterback woes haunt Darkwing Jet. He started Carson Wentz this week, who, since there was no Bridgewater, who was on bye. Cam Newton only got 36. Carson Wentz gets benched in this game and only gets you 11.75 in your biggest time of need. Already said this before earlier today. Just want to point out and reiterate again, Justin, if you had accepted our trade a couple weeks ago, and I assume you would have been starting, might as well just say what it was, Matt Ryan and Calvin Ridley, you would have been starting both of those guys, you would be in the playoffs. You would have won, maybe not this week, but you definitely would have won last week, and you would have been relying on Brian to lose this week, which ended up happening, and Shawshank losing, which ended up happening. So if you had taken our trade, you would not have CMC, who's coming back, and I'm sure everyone in the league is breathing a sigh of relief that CMC is not on the isotopes, but Darkwing, you would have actually locked up a playoff spot had you taken our trade. And like we always say, all you need to do is get in. all you need is a chip and a chair. And who knows what anything can happen in the playoffs here. But yeah, Darkwing Jutt, unfortunately, just could not get to number 7. And he bows out here in week 13. Rest of his team, wide receivers, Woods, Kuti, and Gage, 18.5, 22, and 15. Drake and Singletary, his running backs, 13.8, 11.3. Gesicki finally coming on here too late, much like Michael Thomas there for Ed Lager, 23.8 for Gesicki. Michael Gallup, again, coming on too late here too for you. In the flex here, he goes for 21.5 points just a little bit ago. Kicker Myers from Seattle, 4.5 points. And then the Houston Texans defense, kind of surprised you went with them over the Rams defense, even though they were playing Arizona. They've just been too good this year, I think. And Kyler Murray has been kind of he's been struggling a little bit lately. And said that a matchup, well, they were both divisional matchups here against, but said Houston's got lots of problems, probably would not have played them over the Rams there. They've been too consistently good this year, but I mean, you lost by 53, so it really didn't matter which defense you went with. Even if you had started Cam and the Rams defense, probably not enough points to counter Dub C's point total and perhaps overcome that there. So really not much that Darkwing you could have done with your roster this week to get a victory, other than play somebody else. So the Texans, but their defense, actually Yahoo says 6, but I think we actually knocked you down to 3 because you lost thanks to, they only had 3 sacks and everything else was, you didn't get any points for, so you lost, actually Yahoo said 6. They don't count the -3 for losing, so we knocked you down to only 3 points there for your defense. And with the victory, Dub C Hooligans, he will also finish 6-7, Not sure exactly where his standing will be. Darkwing Jet, with the loss, he will finish 6-7. So that means we will actually have four teams who will be 6-7 here and in the final standings here, heading into the playoffs. But of course, Hillbillies on PCP far and away ahead of the rest of those guys in overall total points here. So that's what gets him that last playoff spot. So Dubsy Hooligans was able to spoil the season for Darkwing Jutt and take him out with him. So, all right, next up, Hillbillies again on PCP, going against Saquon It Ain't So. Hillbillies could have been knocked out of the playoffs, depending on other people's matchups here. But pretty early on, it was evident that Dub-C was going to defeat Darkwing, and Disco was going to defeat Shawshank, and which meant that Hillbillies were already in the number 6 spot there. So it meant, thanks to overall point totals, that once it was clear those two teams were going to lose, it didn't matter what Hillbillies on PCP did in this matchup. If he had won, he could have actually moved up, thanks to other stuff going on. Thanks to Possum Magic's losing, which we will get to in a minute, Hillbillies actually could have moved up to the 5 seed, but since they ended up losing, they stayed in the number 6 seed. So both Hillbillies and Possum could have finished 7-6, but unfortunately, said really Disco and Possum just flip-flopped 4 and 5 there, while Hillbillies, since he lost, he stayed in the 6th seed. Could have knocked Possum Magic down to number 6 there and changed next week's matchups. All right, the final score in this matchup ended up being Saquon It Ain't So, 194.2. Going out with a bang, obviously, here these last 2 weeks. Defeating Hillbillies on PCP, who had 162.75. Because I say that because Saquon It Ain't So defeated Darkwing Jutt last week, and the final catch, Juju. I went and looked it up just to know exactly for sure what happened in the fourth quarter of that Wednesday night Steelers Ravens game, with about eight and a half minutes left. Juju Smith-Schuster caught a 5-yard pass. That was his last catch of the game last week. And that was enough to secure that really narrow victory by Saquon over Darkwing Jutt. About half a point there, thanks to that catch. Just going back here and taking a quick look. So, that catch is, now that we've seen what happened here this week, if that catch effectively ended Darkwing Jutt's season, because that could have been win number 7, which would have, thanks to said Hillbillies on PCP losing this week, that could have been Darkwing Jutt's playoff spot there last week. It's kind of funny that it's Juju Smith-Schuster, because I already said to Justin earlier this evening, what did you do to Juju when he was at Rizzo's? What did he, because he was there at the before the season. What did you say to him? What did you do to Juju that he decided that he felt the need, that he felt compelled here to be the reason that you, to single-handedly be the reason that you don't make the playoffs here? It was him. It's just funny that it was him and he was at Rizzo. Sorry about that, Justin. All right, how about we actually talk about this matchup? Said Saquon It Ain't So took Darkwing Jutt out of the playoffs. Almost could have taken Hillbillies on PCP out as well. Would have been quite the parting shots here from Saquon It Ain't So. at the end of the regular season here. Really could have shaken things up. Kind of did, but let's see. He actually, I think he had Andy Dalton, dropped him, picked up Baker Mayfield, ended up being an excellent decision because Mayfield goes for over 60 points this week, propelling you to victory. Juju, 9.8. Devontae Parker, 7.5. But the big one here in this same game, Cleveland versus Tennessee, you have Corey Davis goes off for 11 catches, 182 yards and a touchdown, 38.2 points. Corey Davis, wow. Never thought I would say that. Saquon's running backs, Gallman and Ingram, 16.5 for Gallman, over 100 yards, but no touchdowns there. Ingram, just under 4 points. Your tight end, you didn't have somebody was out this week, Jonnu Smith. So you picked up Akins, the Texans tight end. He got you 3 points. Landry in the flex, so you had the Mayfield to Landry connection. Man, a lot going on in that Tennessee-Cleveland matchup here. Fortunately, it all worked out for you. All those pieces in that game worked out pretty well. Landry goes for 21.5. Your kicker, Lutz, only 2 points. And then the Colts defense against Houston there. Yahoo says 22. But based on the bump, about 9 points, I'm going to say the score for the Colts defense was 31. And it was enough to get you past Hillbillies on PCP at 162.75, one of his lower scores of the season. He has Roethlisberger go for 56.25. Receivers, Metcalf only 13, Keenan Allen, again, surprised there in that matchup, only 9.8. He's been really on a roll this year. Surprisingly, thanks to, said, that's doctor who wrongly injected Tyrod Taylor with whatever he did to him early in the beginning of the season. Best thing that could have happened to everyone who owned Chargers players. Maybe Tyrod would have been, maybe his performance would have been subpar enough that Herbert would have gotten a chance sooner than later this season. But he got it really early, and Keenan Allen ended up I'm going to assume Keenan Allen would not be putting up the monster numbers this season that he has been had Tyrod Taylor played a significant, if not up to this point in the season there for the Chargers here. So, because I think Keenan Allen is actually, he's like in the top five in overall. Metcalf and Allen there, both, if not top 10, top if not top 5, I should say, definitely top 10. I think Metcalf is up there, and I'm pretty sure Keenan is too, in top 10 overall wide receiver point scorers this season. But again, I don't think he would be there had not Tyrod Taylor gotten sabotaged by that doctor early on in the year. Anyway, Claypool, your other receiver, goes for almost 6. Dalvin Cook, another 27 points. Chubb, 17.5. Hawkinson, your tight end, 15.5. Played Snell in the flex there, only 3 points from him. Prater, about 3 points. And the Pittsburgh Steelers defense, actually don't think they had any turnovers, had a couple sacks. Gave up a decent amount of yardage and ended up losing to the Washington football team. I believe Yahoo says 6, but if I remember correctly, the actual score was 12. So, yeah, thanks to Corey Davis, Baker picking up Baker Mayfield here, and said Landry, the defense there, solid buns, almost 90, over 90 points from Jay's buns this week. Get enough to hand Hillbillies on PCP that loss here, but still, it didn't, thanks to other situations here, it didn't matter really much for Hillbillies, the outcome of this matchup. It determined who you play in the first round of the playoffs, so I guess that kind of matters, but as someone who started off the season 0-4, Hillbillies, I'm sure, will tell you, they don't care how they get into the playoffs. They don't care what seed they are. They just care that they're in and got it. So, Saquon at 8-0, he will finish the season 4-9. Not sure what spot he'll be there. Probably 10th still. And Hillbillies on PCP, he will finish the regular season under 500, 6-7, but he will have that number 6 seed. All right, and finally, the Springfield Isotopes versus Possum Magic. Springfield Isotopes get the victory 212.45 to 178.35, handing Possum Magic another loss this year. The Topes going over, despite Possum Magic putting up a solid score, the Topes go over 200 against him once again, unfortunately for you there. And let's see, in terms of playoffs, this matchup, the Isotopes with that victory locked up the number one seed, held on to it. If they had lost, they could have dropped down to number two. What was Gag's score here? 181. So actually, if the Isotopes had scored 190 or less, even if they had, since they won, Gags could not have overtaken them. But if the Topes had scored 190 or less, and lost this matchup, that could have meant that the Topes would have dropped all the way down to the number three seed. Fortunately for them, they did not. Possum Magic, if he could have won this matchup, I don't think it would have affected his standing there. If he lost, and he actually could have fallen farther than he did, he could have ended up in the sixth seed if Hillbillies had won, but they did not. So I believe, Possum, it says you're 4 here currently, and I believe this loss only dropped you to 5. So it was still, the matchup still here is Disco and Possum here in the first week of the playoffs. All that happened in week 13 here was the two of you flip-flopped seeds there. So with the victory, let's see, Isotopes. Let's see, he had Aaron Rodgers go for 51.5. Receivers, Hopkins, Deontay, and Ridley. 19, 21, and 16, respectively. Kamara goes for 17.7. Aaron Jones, actually 29.8, thanks to his long touchdown there. Fant, tight end, 9.7. Hines in the flex, 12.2. Kicker, Bass from the Buffalo Bills, he goes for about 10 points. And the Seattle Seahawks defense, Yahoo says 19. But I believe the actual score was 26. I think we added 6 points there. So 25, sorry. For the... So I had some solid scores there, up and down. The Isotopes line up this week's 20 or so pointers there to bump them over 200 and get the victory over Possum Magic, said even though he put up a pretty good score. Tannehill goes for 62.5. His receivers, Lockett, McLaurin, and Diggs. 12.5 for Lockett, 3.5, unfortunately, for McLaurin against the Steelers there. They pretty much locked him down. Diggs got you 19.2 on 10 catches there. Derrick Henry, perhaps another surprising outcome here. Still you lost by, 22 and 12 is 34. You lost by 34 points or so. Derrick Henry only got you 6. He would have needed, 40, which is very much possible for Derrick Henry to go out and do. Drop a 40-pointer on anybody here. He's done that multiple times. By multiple, I mean 2 so far this year. Just taking a look at his game log real quick. But fortunately, the Topes breathe a sigh of relief after feeling like we had a good chance to win the matchup after Derrick Henry only got you 6 points. Other running back, Carson, gets you 20. Hayden Hurst, only 2. Marvin Jones in the flex there. He actually goes for 25.5 points. So a good play there in the flex with him. Fairbairn, your kicker, goes for about 10. And then the Chiefs defense, Yahoo says 12. I'm going to say we added about 6 or so to make that about 18 points there. So, yeah. Tannehill did good. Carson did good. Marvin Jones did good. Your defense did all right. Said McLaurin and Henry and Hurst kind of hurt you this week. But said your opponent, went for 212. Just bad luck, kind of more than likely this week because 212, it's not often that we have matchups where both teams go over 200. I think we only had one this year, and that was the podcaster battle. But yeah, it's tough to get a victory anytime your opponent goes over 200 points there. More just bad luck than anything else. Even though, as I said, unfortunately for you, Possum, frustratingly so, I'm sure the Topes did that to you twice this year. So, but you're still in the playoffs. You're in the Possum Magic. He will finish the season 7-6, and he will be in the 5 seed, while Springfield Isotopes will move up to 10-3, and they will finish in first place. Get that 1 seed, regular season championship, that basically winning my money back for the entry fee for that. So Gags, he won the knockout pool. He's won his money back. Topes get their money back thanks to this for the regular season championship. But as it has been said many times, many ways, not Merry Christmas. Nobody gives a shit who wins the regular season championship. All that matters is who finishes at the top at the end of the playoffs. That's the only thing anybody remembers, and thus the only thing that any of us should really care about, other than it feels good to get a bye week and win that win your money back here. Although I can personally testify that what pops to mind right away is several years ago, about almost 10 years ago now, when the Topes won the title in, I think, 2010 and 2011. And in 2012, we were going for the three-peat and would have had the three-peat, except for, because I think that was the year Mighty Midgets won the playoffs here. I can just take a quick look on Yahoo. Yes, that was 2012. The Topes got a first-round bye, just barely got a first-round bye, because I remember very fondly. Week 13 just barely secured that first-round bye. If we had not done that, would have played Mighty Midgets, who at the time was Big Test Icicles, would have played them in the first round of the playoffs and knocked them out. And they are the team who eventually went on to win the Tonto Bowl that year. But if the Topes had played and said would have knocked Big Test Icicles out of the playoffs in that first round, and actually, I believe, would have gone on, I'm almost certain, would have gone on, based on scores, to win the Tonto Bowl, because whoever the Isotopes ended up playing in the second round there, things, because I would have to go back and look at it exactly, who was where in terms of this over in the seedings there, because back then we did not do reseeding, so I would have to go back and look for sure. But the point is, I am almost positive that the Isotopes, if they had not gotten the bye week that year, would have won a Tonto Bowl and made it 3 in a row. So, but I'm not. I've let it go. Not still bothering me at all. But anyway, the point of all of that is, sometimes that bye week is no. It's a blessing and a curse, because you never know exactly what's going to happen. that a team that maybe you could have personally taken out is going to take you out later on. One of the things you dread about the bye week too is that you hate seeing your team go off in week 14 while you're not playing anybody, because more often than not, there's no scientific or actual proof of this other than my kind of gut feeling from doing recaps for all these years now. But more often than not, if your team goes off 1 week, let's say like the Isotopes did this week for 212, if this had been week 14, I would be very nervous going into week 15, because it's highly unlikely that your team is going to repeat a 200-pointer said multiple weeks in a row there. So said if I had gotten that this week, I would be very nervous going into the next week, expecting for my team to kind of said they usually fall a big week usually gets followed up by a subpar week, and subpar weeks are definitely not what you're looking for come playoff time here. So, whew, all right, that is a lot to say. I think I just spoke more in the last 50 minutes than I have the entire past week here. But anyway, let's get down to the real business, which is the playoffs here. The seedings are going to be 1, Isotopes, 2, Yinzer Jags, 3, Gags to Riches, 4, Disco, 5, Possum Magic, and Hillbillies on PCP there with number 6. So, let's go back to the old trusty seeds here, seedings, and see how they've done over the past 10 years and see who is in those seeds and what the past has perhaps told us the future holds for some of these teams here. So again, over the past 10 years, from 2010 to 2019, we'll run through it real quick again. The number 6 seed, so that's you, Brian, the 6 seed, has gone to the Tonto Bowl 3 times. They are 2-1 in the Tonto Bowls, the 6 seed. However, the number 6 seed went to the Tonto Bowl. Those 3 times that they went were 3 times in a row, and they have not actually happened those 3 years where the number 6 seed went to the Tonto Bowl. 2012, 2013, and 2014. So we've gone 5 years without a number 6 seed going to the Tonto Bowl. So that's what you've got here heading into the playoffs there. Brian at the number 6 seed. All right. Number 5 seed, Possum Magic. In the last 10 years, they've gone to the Tonto Bowl 4 times. And number 5 seed is actually 3-1 in Tonto Bowls. So, good sign there. Let's see. Those Tonto Bowls where the 5 seed has gone, all 3 of those Tonto Bowls was the 2 seed versus the 5 seed. 2 of them were actually the Isotopes. In 2010, 2 versus 5, Bigler Disco versus Isotopes. 2015, Possum Magic versus Isotopes. And in 2017, all 3 times that the number 5 seed has won a Tonto Bowl, it has been the Isotopes. Josh versus the Isotopes in 2017 was another 2 versus 5 there. The only time the 5 seed did not win the Tonto Bowl was in 2013 when Gags was number 6 and he defeated Jeff, who is, of course, no longer in the league here. So, Those five seeds have been scattered throughout the last 10 years, so not really any kind of streak going on there for Possum Magic here. But if you do get there, said the five seed has won three times of the four. Next up, number four seed, which is you, Disco. The number four seed has, in the last 10 years, has only made the Tonto Bowl two times. Fortunately, there is a bright side to this. The two times that the number four seed has made it to the Tonto Bowl, they are 2-0, and those two times are the last 2 years, 2018 and 2019. So the number four seed did not make the Tonto Bowl for 8 years at least, until the last 2 years, and the four seed is currently on a 2-year win streak. So Disco will be looking to make the number four seed a Tonto Bowl victor for the third time in a row. All right, bad news here. Number three seed, Gags to Riches, trying to get that back-to-back championship. The number three seed has only gone to the Tonto Bowl one time in the last 10 years, did not win. It was 2016, where actually Gags, you defeated Detling's team in 2016 there. That is the only time. So the three seed is 0-1 in the Tonto Bowl in the last 10 years. So Gags, that three and four seed, perhaps not the places history tells us. History tells us that perhaps those places are not the ones you want to be in. And that is Gags and Disco. So we will, both of you guys are playing next week. This will be coming up. So we will see if either one of you can break the spell and get one step closer to the Tonto Bowl. Next up, number two seed. Arguably the best position to be in, according to the last 10 years, because the number two seed, which is, of course, Yinzer Jags this year, in 10 years, they have gone to the Tonto Bowl six times. 60% of the time, the number two seed makes it to the Tonto Bowl, much like the four seed having a bright spot. That is the bright spot for the two seed, because while the number two seed has gone to the Tonto Bowl six times, their record in Tonto Bowl is 1-5. So five times out of six, the number two seed in the Tonto Bowl has been defeated. So that's not good news for you. Yinzer Jags here, taking a look, said Disco was number two in 2010. They lost. Jay was number two in 2011. He lost. Justin, the number two in 2014, and he was the one who won the Tonto Bowl that year with the two seed. 2015, it was again number two for Possum Magic, but lost to the Topes. 2017, again, Josh losing to the Topes. And again in 2019, Josh was also, once again, the number two seed, and he lost to Gags. So Josh, unlucky there with the number two seed. So again, Yinzer Jags, they've made it to the Tonto Bowl six times, but they have lost five of those times. So we will see how that plays out. Should be pretty interesting. And then finally, the number one seed, the Isotopes this year. In the last 10 years, they have gone to the Tonto Bowl four times. They are split 2-2. Let's see. The number one seed went in 2011, 2012, 2016, and 2018. So we will see what happens. Said again, according to this, I don't know if anybody really paid much attention to it, but in the last 10 years, we have only had one time where the 1 and 2 seed both made their way through the rest of the teams and made it to the Tonto Bowl. The other 9 seasons out of 10, either the number 1 seed or the number 2 seed gets bye week and out. So, of course, that means nothing is guaranteed. Although, let's see, we only had 1 season where it was 1 versus 2. And we've also only had 1 season where neither 1 or 2 made it to the Tonto Bowl. In 2013, it was 5 versus 6 there. So we will see who ends up with the Romo jersey. Who goes? Because it's more than, again, if history tells us anything, at least one of me or Detling will be going bye week and done in the playoffs this year, and will be probably sporting the Romo, hopefully, if it shows up, sporting the Tony Romo jersey. Can't get it done in crunch time, playoff time, much like the real Tony Romo, hence the jersey here. So dominates the regular season and then craps out in the playoffs here. So we'll see what happens. It's going to be an exciting week 14 of the first round of the playoffs. These matchups are both pretty good. Let me take a quick look at the... Let's see if we've got it here. Yeah, Yahoo's already basically... since Possum Magic and Disco are really only switching their spots here, let's take a quick look at week 14. We'll let the podcasters get into it more. But Gags versus Hillbillies, going to be a great matchup. You guys both actually have a lot of tough matchups here in this one. Watson at Chicago. We're going to see, we'll see how for real that Dolphins defense is, as Tyreek and Kelsey will both be traveling to Miami. So that's going to be interesting to see how that plays out. And Gags has 2 defenses on his team, the Giants and the Cardinals. They're playing each other. He's currently got the Giants in there. Perhaps a good play. So we'll see what happens. But you got rest of your lineup's not too bad. Montgomery versus Houston could be really good. As for Hillbillies on PCP, personally, I am leery about this matchup. The Steelers going to Buffalo. Really kind of expected that they would beat Washington last night. And personally, it's been my opinion for a few weeks now that I think, at least I thought, the Steelers were going to get their, they were going to get their first loss this matchup going to Buffalo. At Buffalo, who knows what the weather conditions will be like. Always a tough place to play, even though there's no crowds there. Steelers away from home, play letdown games, even against subpar opponents there. But Buffalo is gonna give them all they can handle. Really depends on how well the defense Buffalo shows up. They could definitely, I think, really show up this week and make Roethlisberger's day pretty difficult. Connor's coming back. They might try to run the ball this week. However, the thing that's been one of the key components that's been carrying Roethlisberger for Hillbillies on PCP this year is that especially lately, the Steelers have all but abandoned the running game, and Roethlisberger is throwing the ball 40, 50 times a game, and when you've got points for every completion, that's fantasy gold. But I think they're going to struggle this week. Maybe I'm wrong. We'll see how that plays out. But I'm sure you're going to, since I think Connor's back, so you'll probably take Snell out of your lineup there. So we'll see exactly what Hillbillies sets for his lineup. Looks like he currently has 2 tight ends in there, Hockenson and Henry. The thing I think will be a problem here is Cook and Chubb. Dalvin's playing at Tampa Bay. Chubb is playing Baltimore. Both those teams, even though Tampa Bay has been kind of, their defense has kind of trailed off recently, They are definitely a good run defense team that could very well target Dalvin Cook and try to shut him down. While also Baltimore, good run defense team, so Chubb might struggle against them. And then you got a Steelers defense at Buffalo. I think they're going to struggle against that offense. I mean, you've rolled with them all year long. Not really sure you could bench them for anybody else. They're just too good in terms of potential. But I think this is going to be a tough matchup for the Steelers there. And both teams here, Gags and Hillbillies, their guys have some tough matchups. Some of their key players have tough matchups. So this is going to be a really interesting and a fun matchup to watch. And the other matchup, Disco versus Possum. Let's take a look at what your lineups are going to look like. We'll see how Mahomes does against Miami at Miami. Their defense has been, they've been playing pretty well. Although Mahomes absolutely tore apart the Ravens defense earlier this year. So I'm sure he is not intimidated. That's for sure. Your receivers right now, I'm sure you'll be putting Godwin in there. Marquise Brown, who knows? Said about Galladay here. He's kind of been, just can't seem to get healthy this year. So I assume it's going to be Godwin, Marquise Brown, and Mike Williams there. Then your running backs. You got Dobbins and Taylor in from this past week. I assume those guys will be in. But you could probably, because it looks like Jacobs might not. You got a stud running back there and Jacobs on your bench, but he's injured. And I think that it's trending towards him once again not playing this week. So we will see what happens. That could be a problem there for you. Dobbins will be going up again. If you play Dobbins again, he's going up against Cleveland. They're a good defense too. They just held Derrick Henry to 5-6 points there. So then you got Taylor, Waller. He's got Indianapolis. That's a good defense. He's not going to put up another 50 points. But then you got Zeke going against Cincinnati. That could be a big one here for you. And then the Redskins. It's still the first year. I think most of us should be allowed to slide with the accidental slip ups of there. I don't think you're going to play Tampa Bay's defense against Minnesota. But probably a better play is the Reds. Washington at San Francisco. They got their backup quarterback going. It's definitely potential for some turnovers there. Maybe some lower yardage, considering they just shut down the Steelers pretty well. Mahomes. Probably you'll be looking for big things from Zeke there this week and your defense, so we'll see what happens. Then we got Poston Magic. If I'm Disco, I am worried, actually, because he's got Tannehill and Derrick Henry, who just had a bad game. I would expect Derrick Henry. They are playing at Jacksonville, so most likely going to have some good weather, and Henry's probably angry, and there's a team that you don't want to see Henry going up against as an opponent. When he's angry, it's going to be Jacksonville. That's a potential for an even bigger day than Zeke here. If I'm Disco, that's my biggest concern for Possum Magic, is that Derrick Henry and maybe Tannehill. That could end up there, because Tennessee's defense has been pretty subpar lately. That's a game that could end up being a shootout. And Tannehill and Henry could both go off in that matchup here. McLaurin just got shut down against the Steelers. He'll probably be looking to have a big bounce back game there. Diggs against the Steelers this week. Maybe they will shut him down like they did McLaurin this past week. Tyler Lockett, though, he has been... I'd be nervous about this one too, because Tyler Lockett has been really... he's been pretty quiet for a while now, and you just know that he can pop off for 20, 30, 40 points on you at any given week. You just never know when those weeks are going to be. And Seattle's playing the Jets. That could be pretty good. But Sidhurst for you has been pretty subpar this week. You'll be depending on what Marvin Jones does. Chiefs defense might be okay against Miami, depending on how good Miami's offense can do. Just looking at your bench, maybe you'll put in Logan Thomas for Hayden Hurst, since he just had a pretty good week, and Hurst has kind of been disappointing there. That's the only difference I think you might make in your lineup here. But yeah, this should be another really solid matchup. Possum said, if Mahomes can do what Mahomes thinks, overall, I think the lineup on Possum is better. But said it's going to depend on what those Tennessee Titans do this week. If Derrick Henry goes off, it's going to be big problems for Disco. Said he got Lockett and McLaurin. Potential for Possum Magic to really just blow up this week. Much more potential for a big blow up than I think just looking at your lineups than Disco has. Looking at your lineups. Especially since Waller blew up last week. Don't think that'll happen again this week. He's always potentially good for 25 points or so. But the rest of your lineup, you got some question marks there. Again, just like the other matchup, this is going to be a really good one. I don't know who's going to win. But again, I think it could definitely go to Possum Magic. He is much more likely to have a huge week based on who he's got. Personally attacking Disco or anything, targeting him or anything. I'm just saying that because some of Possum's big guns fizzled last week, they're going to be looking to bounce back this week and have some big games. So that's what I'm worried about if I am Disco. Otherwise, this is going to be another entertaining and hopefully close down to the wire, exhilarating for the rest of us to watch, nauseating for the people who are in the matchups to see what happens here. So, hopefully no COVID problems this week. I see Disco has one player. If he plays Dobbins, he'll have two Ravens once again on Monday night. So this matchup won't be decided until Monday night. As for Gags and Hillbillies, he's got Chubb on Monday night. And you've got Tucker on Monday night. Yeah, so these matchups might not be decided until after the Monday night games there. So they're going to be fun to watch. I'm looking forward to it and excited to see exactly how things play out here. So, all right. Way too long podcast, but hopefully you enjoyed a little bit of those seed previews and how things look like we're going to go. I didn't get into the matchups, I think, too crazily, because that's not my responsibility. Said both of them a little bit there. Maybe the podcasters will get into it a little bit in more detail, since they'll only have two matchups to talk about this week here. So, all right. As we approach the 1 hour and 15 minute mark here, that's definitely long enough. Thanks to everyone who said played this season but is already out. Always great to have you guys. Everybody there. Everybody at the draft, good times. Always good to get us all back together for our yearly Tontos Demise Best Fantasy Football League around. Said again, thank you to all the guys who, even though you're already out of the playoffs, for contributing, having another great season, making us have another great season here. And we will look forward to seeing all of you come back next year and try to bounce back into the playoffs here. The rest of us who will still, the half of us who will still be carrying on into the playoffs, good luck to everyone, hopefully. We have some COVID problems. We've been having them the past few weeks here. Hopefully things stay under control these next couple weeks and we smoothly get through the playoffs. Hopefully everyone avoids injuries this week. Hopefully the teams in the playoffs, all of your players meet or exceed expectations. And we have two slugfests here in the first round of the playoffs. I'm excited to see what happens. So, all right. Thanks everyone for listening or watching or whatever it is you do. Assuming any of you get to this point in any of the reviews. Maybe you do, maybe you don't, I don't know. But anyway, thanks for again, and we will see you back here next week to recap the events of Week 14, Round 1 of the playoffs. Can't wait to see what happens. So again, thanks guys, and we'll see you back here again next week.